Greetings, Benjamin J. the Victrola Guy. Part 2 of Complete Disassembly of the Edison Standard B Cylinder Phonograph. Now in Part 1, we removed all the parts from the machine. I put this shaft back in just to have some place to put it. But one thing I neglected to do was to remove that bearing in Part 1. So we're going to remove it now. So what I use is, you can use a wooden dowel. There's no way to get hold of this to pull it out. It has to be pushed out. And you can sometimes use the mandrel, but I don't recommend doing that. So what I use is, this is a little nylon rod, and all you have to do is slide it into the casting, and then take a small hammer, and then just tap that bearing out. There we go. That simple. And as I said, these bearings get covered in oxide, so you can take a razor knife and you can see all this discoloration. And that's why these bearings get so tight, because it actually forms a coating on them of oxide, which makes them physically bigger. And that's what freezes them in the casting, that and rust, of course. But this is cast iron and this is steel, so they have two completely different coefficients. But you can see the discoloration on this bearing. And rather than trying to clean it with an abrasive, like a garnet paper, just take an old razor knife and scrape it in straight lines. And you can see this junk coming off. And the metal's getting bright silver again, as you can see. And once you've scraped all that corrosion off, the bearing can be pushed straight through the hole. It really makes a tremendous difference in its size. So this oxide actually increases its diameter by a thousandth of an inch or so. Makes it almost impossible to move. And surprisingly, after you've scraped it, like I said, you can just push it straight through the hole. So it makes a tremendous difference. So we've now removed the mandrel bearing as well. So we're now ready to remove the motor from the machine. So to do that, we're going to remove the 5 wood screws that anchor the bed plate to the cabinet itself. Now in most cases, at least one of these wood screws is going to be stripped, and it'll just sit there and turn rather than unscrewing. And no, it came out. Okay. I hope you can see this all right. Okay, all 5 of these came out. And these are just wood screws. And there's a good trick. You can go down and find a brass screw that is actually about 2/1000 larger than this. And you can then put brass screws in the machine, and it takes up the slop where those holes are stripped. You can also epoxy a toothpick, or white glue a toothpick, into each hole, break it off flush, let it harden, and just put the wood screw back in. So in any case, we've now removed those 5 screws. So we make sure your crank is removed. And also, one thing I really have to caution anybody who's going to be working on an Edison cylinder phonograph: don't attempt to do anything to this machine with a motor wound. Don't try to do anything to it until you really, really know this machine well. Let it run down before you do anything to it. Don't attempt to even turn a screw with the motor wound. Always let it run all the way down before you do anything to an Edison cylinder phonograph. There's a tremendous amount of power in that spring. And if you inadvertently trip the crank or the ratchet for the crank, it will instantly unwind and break the mainspring. Okay, so we just lift up on the bed plate, turn it over, and put it back into the cabinet. And there's our motor. Now, the motor is mounted on springs. Now, this is the Edison B. On the Edison A, it is not mounted on springs. It's screwed directly to the bed plate. And the whole idea of the spring mounting was of course, to provide some shock resistance and to cut down on vibration of resonating noise. So we've turned the bed plate over. This is our motor. And there's 3 screws with 2 springs, a spring on the top and a spring on the bottom in most cases. So we're going to take the back one out first. We unscrew the screw, and there's the spring. So there's one. There's two. And the one in the front, right here. And usually these things are pretty gummy because of all the oil that's been splattered on them for the last 100 years or so. And let's see if this one is going to come out. Not yet. All right. And the third screw. And this one is really sticky. I'm trying to do this with my webcam, of course. Well, it's going to have to come out with the motor. So we lift the motor up. There's that screw that didn't want to come out. And there we go. And there's the screw. There's the motor. There's the bed plate. Now, this case, as I said, is literally falling apart. So I'm going to pull this apart, re-glue it, and check it out as much as I can as far as repairing all the damage to the case. Now, this case is in pretty poor shape. This has had water damage, and it's literally just falling apart everywhere. I can just pull this frame apart. So there's your bed plate, front and back. Really, really simple to do, and what I'm going to do is now strip this bed plate, and there's a couple of ways to do it. I've found that epoxy remover, it's a thick gel. It is extremely toxic and really corrosive. You have to be really careful using it. And I just put this in an aluminum pan, and this epoxy remover is a gel. You put it on with a natural bristle brush, let it set for a few hours, and you can come in and scrape it right down to the bare metal. We're not going to sand it. We're not going to sand blast it. We're going to do this the easiest, simplest way possible, getting all the paint off of it, getting it down to the bare metal, and then we're going to clean it as best we can, primer it, and then repaint it. Now, we're also going to be removing the ID plate. Now, when they installed these, those aren't rivets in there. They look like rivets, but they're not. They're actually brass nails that are pushed through and bent over. And you're going to have to use a pair of side cutters or something like that to get hold of these things and pry them up. And you're not going to be able to reuse them. So usually what you can do is cut them off and just use the top part and epoxy them back in. So once you get them bent up, you can put a screwdriver under it usually. And as this comes up, it usually breaks right off. So that one's coming up. Let me get a pair of pliers here. Straighten it up as best you can, and as I said, they always break off, and it did. So now the same thing with this one. Grab it with some side cutters. Because all you have to do is get it up to the point where you can get something under it, like a screwdriver. And straighten it up. Grab it with a pair of pliers, and as you straighten it, as I said, it will almost invariably break off. And there it goes. Alright, so now we've got two little brass nubs, and you can see them really, really well. So I take a little tiny screwdriver. In this case, I'm going to use my pincers, my tweezers. Just give it a push just to get them started on the other side. There's one. Remember, these things have been in here since the day they painted the case. There it goes. So we turn the bed plate over, and there is our ID plate. And underneath it is 100-year-old paint that hasn't seen the light of day and since the day they actually riveted this to the machine. So we can clean this up and make it look virtually new again. And if you happen to lose those pins, whatever you want to call them, rivets, just use round head finishing nails and just push them through, bend them over. What a lot of people do is simply epoxy the originals back into position, just like that, and let them set. So the bed plate is ready for painting. We can get this stripped, get it primered, get it painted, and we can have an Edison cylinder phonograph that looks virtually new. So all these are going to get stripped, and I think I'll actually do this as a separate video showing you how to remove and then adjust this feed nut. And there's a really good trick about the push button, and I'll probably do that in the same video. So for now, you've completely stripped the bed plate of its parts. The motor is off of it. It is now ready to be stripped, primered, and painted. It's actually physically in decent shape. It's just this paint is, and you can just scrape it off, as you see. It's in really, really terrible condition. And I just wanted to show you what you can do, because when we're done with this machine, I think you're going to be really surprised. It is going to be actually a quite nice cylinder phonograph. So in any case, I hope this was of some interest and of some help. Part three, we'll be working on the motor, pulling it apart. We're going to be pulling the case apart. How much of that I'm going to do videos of, I don't know. But this case is just literally falling apart. I could flex this right now and probably just break the entire thing off. It is in really, really poor condition. And this is all water damage. And all the glue has let go. And it's just all the varnish is gone off the outside of the case. It's just in really, really poor condition. So not sure what I'm going to do with the case yet. But I hope that this will be of some value, especially when we get to the motor. Pulling the gearbox, and of course I'm going to be pulling the spring out of it, re-greasing it, and reinstalling it. So, as far as I know, this is going to be the only video on YouTube of actually rebuilding the Edison cylinder phonograph. So if you have any questions or comments, please feel free to drop me an email to victrolaguy@gmail.com. This is part two, the complete disassembly of the Edison Standard B cylinder phonograph. Part three, we're going to start on the motor, and then we'll take it all from there. So as always, if you have any questions or comments, please feel free to drop me an email, thevictrolaguy@gmail.com. And as always, thank you for watching.